Good evening, and thank you for joining us here at the Mechanics Institute, here at 57 Post Street, San Francisco. I'm Laura Shepherd, Director of Events, and I'm very pleased to welcome you to our program with Joyce Carol Oates for her new book, Beautiful Days, Stories. Now, for those of you who are new to the Mechanics Institute, we'd like to invite you to come on Wednesday at noon for a free tour of the library and our beautiful Beaux-Arts building. Also, become a member and attend most of our programs for free. The Mechanics Institute continues to be one of the most vital cultural and literary centers in the Bay Area, with ongoing author events such as this, panels, cinema lit film series, book clubs, computer classes, writers groups, and chess classes and tournaments, and much more, 7 days a week, all through the year. So please visit our website and also pick up our event schedule. With over 40 books to her name, she hardly needs introduction. The breadth of her writing ranges in themes from popular culture to the most probing issues of our times. From her first novel about the fraught relationship of lovers in With Shuddering Fall, to her 700-page novel, Blonde, devoted to the life of Marilyn Monroe, to her recent politically charged family drama, A Book of American Martyrs, and her many collections of masterful short stories, Joyce Carol Oates never fails to bring her fearless passions and astounding insights to the page. In her new collection, Beautiful Days, she features 13 stories, including the 2017 Pushcart Prize-winning Undocumented Alien, and explores the most secret, intimate, and unacknowledged interior lives of characters. These stories will shock, inspire, and get under your skin. Please note that Joyce's first book, now reprinted with Shuddering Fall, and her most recent novel, A Book of American Martyrs plus Beautiful Days, will be on sale and signing after our program. And now an introduction. Joyce Carol Oates is the recipient of the National Medal of Humanities, the National Book Critics Circle Ivan Sandroff Lifetime Achievement Award, the National Book Award, and the Penn Malamud Award for Excellence in Short Fiction. She has written some of the most enduring fiction of our time, including the national bestsellers, We Were the Mulvaneys, Blonde, which I just mentioned, which was nominated for the National Book Award, and the New York Times bestseller, The Falls, which won the 2005 Prix Femina. She is the Roger S. Berlin Distinguished Professor of Humanities at Princeton University, and has been a member of the American Academy of Arts and Letters since 1978. She is wintering in the Bay Area with her husband, Professor Charles Gross, and teaching at UC Berkeley's English department. So we are so lucky to welcome Joyce Carol Oates.
Thank you for the gracious introduction. Can you all hear me? And we didn't really realize we were wintering in Berkeley. Though we would much rather be there than back home where there's a blizzard and it's like a foot of snow, but it's not actually very warm in Berkeley. It's been dreary and wet and rainy for quite a while. But we're not complaining because we're not back home. So I'm really happy to be here. It's such an elegant and such a unique and interesting library. Just wonderful windows and just the very look of it. So luxurious and sort of magisterial. Plus we were taken to the chess club area upstairs, which is so amazing. I've never seen a library with a chess club in it. In fact, I don't think I've ever seen a chess club before. It'd make a really wonderful setting for a story. Just the idea of the chess club and the people who come and meet one another, who have such disparate lives and come from great different parts of the city and different ages, and it would be very fascinating. Well, this evening I'll talk a little bit about my book, but I'm going to read a new story because I'd like to read new work, which I'm more emotionally engaged with. But I'll talk about the book a little bit. Probably the nicest thing about the book is the Edward Hopper cover. I was so thrilled to be able to use this cover. I've had two or three Hopper covers before on my books, and there is just that somewhat iconic, mystical, dreamlike, exemplary sort of humanity without anyone being too specific. There doesn't seem to be a particular history or particular time. It seems maybe it's back in the 1930s or sometime like that, but it's not specific. And that dreamlike quality and allegorical quality are what we look for, I think, in art. Most of my books of stories, maybe all of my books of stories, have a strategy of organization. Often I have three sections. There are only two in this, but I often have three. And I begin I strike a certain thematic tone with the very first story or even the first line. It's a love story that takes people to places that they had not anticipated. And I think the reader may be surprised also, since the writer was surprised at where the people ended up. But it's a realistic story. It's extremely realistic with a sense of place. Fleur Bleu, the Blue River, and it's set in an area that is very vividly realized. Then the next story is called Big Burnt. For those of you who know where Lake George is, that's another very beautiful, extremely beautiful lake in the Adirondacks, upstate New York. Big Burnt, I love the name of that. And my husband spent his summers on Big Burnt Island, so it has that kind of connection. Then a story called Owl Eyes, which is about a young boy. He's 15 years old and he's a prodigy. Sometimes I write about teenage boys and maybe a few girls, and they turned out to be somewhat precocious. Except You Bless Me is a story about racial misunderstanding, and the reader, I think, will know more maybe than the character in the story. Then there's a story called The Quiet Car, which is based on the quiet car in the New Jersey Transit. This is a car in the train where people don't talk. And for many of us, it's like the happiest time. I was teaching at NYU last fall, and every Tuesday I went in the quiet car. It was sort of a sacred time. The same people would come in every week, and they would quickly go to their seats and not look at, you don't look at one another. You just sort of don't make any contact at all. Everybody's sitting in their little seats. And so forth. The Bereaved is set in the Galapagos. Maybe some of you know what the Galapagos is. My husband Charlie and I went to the Galapagos about 2 years ago and had all sorts of interesting adventures, though nothing quite like in the story here. Then the stories start to shift a little. They become maybe more interior. They start to acquire a kind of surrealist tone. And the Les Belles Jours, which is The Beautiful Days, is based on a notorious Baltus painting. And I didn't want that Baltus painting on the cover of my book because then it would be censored or people would be angry about it. But it just turned out that particular Baltus painting drew a lot of ire at the Metropolitan Museum, and some people have petitioned to have it taken down. But I don't think that's going to happen. I'm not sure what I think about art, because John Veerman said, "Is wickedness soluble in art?" Meaning, can you have wicked subjects, but if the art is brilliant enough, it sort of alleviates it. I'm not sure how I feel about that. Then I have a story called Fractal, which I think is my favorite story in the volume. It's about a mother who takes her quite precocious son to a fractal museum in New England. And that was a story that was unexpected to me. Undocumented Alien was based upon a special issue of Conjunctions magazine, in which the editor Brad Morrow invited people to write about aliens in undocumented or so-called illegal immigrants, or the idea of somebody who's been alienated, who's estranged, who is looked upon as different. And so my story is based upon that theme. It's also about a sort of lurid neurological experiment. Then a story called Donald Barthelme Saved from Oblivion. If anyone remembers and likes Donald Barthelme, this story is really like a Valentine or homage to Donald Barthelme, whom I knew a bit. I was a kind of a friend of his, though I think not a close friend of his. So much of the story, or at least some of the story, is taken from Don's writing, and there are lines and weird metaphors and things. And then there are other things that I invented that are Donald Barthelme-like, which I wouldn't have done by myself in my own writing, but here it makes sense. Like, Don believed in art for art's sake. So I have a little scene in here where art shows up, and he's a person. He says, well, I'm the person that you're doing all this for. I'm art of art's sake. And I think Don would have appreciated that wit. He would have had a kind of a crooked smile. Then the last story is called The Memorial Field at Hazard, Minnesota. And it's more like an incantatory prose poem, which is about, it has a political dimension to it. But I wrote it before the current debacle in Washington. I actually wrote it about two back, and the story has been sort of gestating since then, about how in a democracy we elect people, and they feel, because they've been elected, that maybe the responsibility is absolved, and they're not that responsible. In a democracy, people have elected the leader. At the same time, in a democracy, people themselves sometimes don't feel responsible for the people they've elected because they have so little actual control over the mechanism. So tonight I'm going to read a new story that I wrote not too long ago. I'd like to read something that I have emotional engagement with, and I've never read this before. It's been accepted at some magazine, but it hasn't been published yet. It's called The Bloody Head. A love story. Well, you're laughing already. How'd you know it's going to be funny? In the secluded inner courtyard of the Hotel d'Abbey on the Rue de la Cassette, Paris, the American woman sat alone at a small wrought iron table at breakfast. She was skimming the European edition of the New York Times, which was scarcely recognizable here, thin of lavish full-page advertisements. She was making out postcards for family and friends back home, though she understood that postcards had become passé, quaint gestures from a pre-digital age at which her young grandchildren, enthralled by texting, would only glance quizzically. It was early, not yet 7:15 a.m. Fewer than half the tables in the courtyard were occupied. A fountain at the center of the courtyard made comforting sounds as of a slow pumping heart, soothing and restful and yet suggesting promise. The American woman was the only individual in the courtyard at this time without a companion, which gave her a sense of expansion and exhilaration. Maybe some of you know this hotel. It's a lovely little hotel on the Rue de la Cassette. That morning, she intended to visit the Musée d'Orsay. She would not be hurried through the elegant high-ceilinged rooms and would not press herself to see every work of art on display. She might return the next day to the d'Orsay, or she might go to another smaller museum. There are many small museums listed in the guidebook, including the Musée Picasso, of much interest. Later, she would stroll along the Seine with no particular destination, rejoicing in her freedom amid the languid beauty of Paris in autumn. And here, too, she would feel no pressure to hurry. She was an attractive woman of late middle age with faded fair hair and a smile that came easily in formal settings like this. She was unfailingly gracious with service people, indeed with everyone she encountered. She wore a white linen jacket and perfectly creased white linen trousers with ropes of pearls around her neck. On her head, a fashionably wide-brimmed straw hat. On her feet, her most comfortable low-heeled shoes. The American woman's name was not Isabel Archer. but closely enough resembled that classic name that the woman had come to think of herself in secret as a descendant of Henry James's naively noble-minded heroine, one who'd avoided the tragedy of Isabel Archer's constricted life. Sure chance it was for most women, an accident of time and generations, if they lived freely or not. Isabel Archer, whom Henry James had adored, had been a lady, inescapably. But no woman was required to be a lady in the 21st century. The American woman was making annotations in her Paris guidebook when she became aware of guests at other tables glancing upward at a third floor window of the hotel and then shifting their eyes away. She heard a chilling, strangulated cry and turned in astonishment to see how in an open window a man was calling, "Help, help me," unmistakably in English. The man appeared to be only partly clothed. At least what the American woman could glimpse of his chest and part of his belly appeared to be bare. Clumsily, the man had wound himself in something white, a sheet or towel, but there was also something white wound around his head. "Help, help me." Oh, what was wrong with the poor man? Why did no one seem to care? The American woman tried to signal the eloquently black-clad hostess who had been hovering at the periphery of the courtyard, but the hostess was now nowhere to be seen. A waiter who had been pouring coffee had vanished as well. The American woman did not want to become involved. Desperately, she did not want to become involved. The fleeting thought came to her, "I can't give up the promise of my beautiful morning. I will not." If only she'd slipped away from the courtyard a few minutes before. But still, the man in the third floor window was calling for help desperately. Indeed, he seemed to be calling now to her, since the others were looking stonily away. Why was it always thus she was responsible? She could not ignore the man as others were doing. He spoke English. No doubt he was an American like herself and must have had no one to take care of him. Instinctively, the American woman reached for her handbag, which contained her passport, credit cards, currency, and enough tissues for an entire day, and hurried from the courtyard, which is bounded on three sides by hotel walls and on the fourth open to the hotel lobby. At the front desk, there was no one. Though she rang the brass bell several times, no one appeared from the office. Oh, where were they all hiding? Why would no one help? Though she knew that the quaintly small lift that could not hold more than three adults at a time would be slow to arrive, yet she wasted precious seconds waiting for it, then gave up and ran up the carpeted steps to the second floor and to the third, now breathless and crying softly to herself, "My morning, my beautiful morning." In a third floor corridor, the American woman tried to calculate where the man's room was. Obviously, he had to be overlooking the courtyard at the center of the hotel, and so made her blundering way in what she believed to be that direction, seeing at the far end of the corridor a door that was ajar, though a sign was looped over the doorknob, "Do not disturb." The stricken man had had enough sense to leave the door open, at least, if he wanted someone to come help him. The American woman entered the room hesitantly with an anticipation of something terrible and was astonished to see a naked man of late middle age, somewhat heavy, his chest and belly covered in glinting silver hairs, seated slouched on the bed, badly bleeding and stunned. He had wound a white towel around his head, but blood was seeping through the towel, streaming down his neck, onto his fleshy shoulders and back, and onto the glittering chest hairs. His face was a lurid mask of red through which his widened eyes, glassy white with alarm, shone. "Thank God, help me. See if you can stop this bleeding." The voice was both desperate and reproachful, as if he had been waiting an unconscionably long time for the American woman to ascend to him and was reaching the end of his patience. "No choice, I have no choice," the American woman thought, despite the white linen jacket and the white linen trousers. She had no choice but to come to the assistance of the stricken man, who seemed to have no one else to help him, and was trying to explain to her in a rush of words like a vehicle creeping downhill. He'd had an accident in the bathroom, slipped on the tile floor, fell hard and struck his head against the porcelain toilet and could hardly move for some minutes. Maybe he'd lost consciousness. It happens too quickly for him to comprehend. Then with much difficulty, he'd managed to get to his feet, maneuver himself to his feet, by first turning over and kneeling and then grabbing hold of the sink and lifting himself, grunting, in a delirium of shock and pain. And he'd seen himself in the mirror bleeding from a cut in his head, at the crown of his head, and grabbed a towel and hoped to stop the bleeding, but the bleeding hadn't stopped. Or anyway, he wasn't sure if it had stopped. He couldn't see the actual wound. So maybe she could look, she could help determine if the bleeding had stopped. Of course, the American woman came to the pleading man as he bade her. Gingerly, she removed the blood-soaked towel from his head and saw, with a sensation of faintness, what appeared to be a deep wound in the scalp, or in any case, a wound that was badly bleeding that turned his silvery hair a savage hue of red and was even now bleeding onto his shoulders. Here, use this. Thrusting into her hands the thick white towel he'd wound clumsily about his body that was only partly soaked with blood. But this towel was really too big, and brisk as a nurse, the American woman fetched from the bathroom another smaller towel to be wound like a turban around the bloody head with care, for the towel must not work loose and fall off. And this she managed, though without much help from the agitated man, who continued to describe, in a voice of incredulity, how the accident had happened. How it had happened to him. And nothing like this had ever happened to him before. It was a damn bathroom, the slippery tub, the too small bath mat. How quickly it had happened. He'd found himself on the floor and his head was oozing blood, and there was no one to call to, no one to help. He'd been left alone in the damn room. And when he staggered into the bedroom to call the front desk, the damn phone did not work, or he had no idea how to operate it. And so he had no choice but to stagger to the damn window and call down to the courtyard, making a spectacle of himself. And no one had come for the longest time, though he'd seen her looking at him. Obviously, she'd heard him, but had not seemed to react at once as he'd have expected. But thank God you're here. The American woman was still upset. Her heart was racing dangerously, for the sight of the badly bleeding naked man slouched on the bed had been, in the first instant, terrifying. But it did seem that the stricken man might not be in great danger, so far as the woman could determine the bleeding was beginning to slow. His skull had surely not been fractured. The scalp wound was probably less severe than it appeared, for excessive bleeding was common from even shallow scalp wounds, as the stricken man was assuring her. For he seemed to know all about such matters, using the term vascularized, there being many more small veins in the scalp than elsewhere in the body, and all close to the surface of the skin. Which was why the man said he wouldn't need to see a doctor, no need to go to hospital. In a few minutes, he was all right. He would be all right, he was sure. All this while, as the man spoke, the American woman was trying to breathe calmly and deeply and not to be caught up in the man's rushed words and his hint of reproach. For there was something about the man's forceful head-on manner, like that of a vehicle careening downhill, that might draw another in its wake, like a scrap of paper in an updraft. When she could interrupt the flow of his speech, she managed to tell him that she'd come as quickly as she could. It was true she'd lost precious time waiting for the elevator before deciding to run up the steps. And the man cursed the elevator. Why do they make elevators so small in Europe? Did everybody used to be dwarfs? And with an air of reproach tinged with some humor, for this was an exaggeration, surely, if you'd waited for the damn thing, I'd be dead by now. By degrees, the American woman was feeling less faint. She was not by nature an excitable person, and the proximity of others who were excitable or overwrought had a disorienting effect upon her. At a distance, she imagined she could control such persons, or at least guide them, but closer to them within their gravitational orbit, she soon lost the thread of her own concentration and succumbed to theirs. But it seemed clear that the stricken man was calmer too and less agitated, since his bloody head had been wound by the woman tightly, comfortingly, in a proper-sized towel, like a tourniquet. He was aggrieved, yet managed to speak cogently and not incoherently, like a man who has gained control of an emergency situation and could begin to assess it with an expression of incredulity, disbelief, and annoyance, but amusement too, a man accustomed to giving orders and to being obeyed, but also a man who is unaccustomed to being so incapacitated, so bereft of control at the mercy of another in such a dramatic visual display of masculine helplessness. By this time, the American woman had determined that he was probably all right. She could leave him for a minute sitting on the bed and went to fetch from the bathroom washcloths soaked in hot water, more towels. She would wash the blood from his neck, which was a thick, muscular neck, alarmingly crimson in the morning sunlight slanting through the window. She would wash the blood from his back, his chest, his upper arms, for she did not trust the man in his condition to return to the shower, as with a half-hearted sort of bravado he was suggesting. He would need to see a doctor, she told him. She would arrange for an ambulance to take them to a hospital. But no doctor, no hospital. The man insisted he would be all right in 10 minutes. He had no intention of going to a hospital, none. The woman objected, of course he must go. The wound in his scalp required stitches. No, absolutely not, no hospital here. They'll all be speaking French. He was being ridiculous, the woman cried. He'd seriously hurt himself. He might have died. She would notify the front desk that he needed medical treatment. They would call an ambulance, or at least a taxi. At the nearest emergency room, he could be examined, an x-ray taken of his skull. For what if there had been a fracture and the wound must be cleaned more thoroughly? Disinfected was needed to prevent infection. The wound would have to be stitched up properly so that it would heal and not continue to ooze blood. No, still the man objected. There was not a chance he would go to a hospital in Paris. It was just the shock of it, the accident. A little blood wouldn't hurt him. He'd had worse head wounds as a kid. It's well known that head wounds bleed like hell but heal quickly, so vascularized. What he needed urgently was to get dressed, to get out of this hellhole, all this mess, look at the bedclothes, look at the towels. He needed to go downstairs to the courtyard, that great place with a fountain, and have breakfast, croissants and jam. Why he'd slipped was partly he was damn hungry. The woman could not bring herself to argue with the man since it only excited him, and it was not likely that his wishes would be overcome regarding doctor, hospital, stitches. He would never consent to go now that he'd begun to feel stronger and the shock of the fall was fading. So the woman pleaded with the man at least come into the bathroom so she'd wash him more thoroughly. He couldn't get dressed otherwise. He would get his clean clothes bloodstained. And there was blood in his hair that would have to be rinsed out before it dried, and they would never be able to get it out. With a nervous sort of exasperation, the woman spoke, yet vast relief as well. Her heart was pounding so rapidly, she feared she might faint after all. Oh, she was looking white-faced, the man said, with sudden concern. Maybe she'd better sit down. No, she'd sit down later. She'd finish her breakfast with him. Now she needed to wash away the rest of the blood so that no one would see it. A shocking amount of blood in the bedclothes, the woman saw, appalled. The front desk would have to be alerted. If a housemaid entered the room unaware, the poor woman would be horrified, thinking that someone had been murdered. The man was concentrating on heaving himself to his feet, which took some effort. It was clear that this was a man who'd once been stronger, more certain of his body, and better coordinated. Difficult for him to realize now that he no longer inhabited that body, though he was he? Exactly the same person. Indeed, he could probably not have managed to stand without the woman slipping an arm around his waist and gripping him tight. He was panting, though also laughing, or making a sound of a certain sort of incredulous laughter that signaled, oh, how could this happen? How to me? Nothing like this ever happened in my life, but it's nothing really ridiculous to make such a fuss. In the bathroom, the woman went hot water into the sink, used the excellent fragrant soap to wash the man's neck as he stood submissively before her with an air of patience. From time to time, he stole sidelong glances at himself in the mirror, smiling ruefully, wincing, allowing the woman to wash him as if humoring her, acquiescing to another's overzealous solicitude out of consideration for the woman. Though he stooped to help her when required and took his hairbrush from her hands to make swipes at his silvery white hair that was disheveled and wild, and marveled at what he could glimpse of the wound in the mirror, whistling thinly as if the wound were quite an achievement. Though wincing when the woman daubed gently at the wound, warning her not to start the damn bleeding again, please. The woman saw that the interior of the bathroom looked like, what was the French word? An abattoir. Smeared blood on the impractically white tile floor, but also the edge of the bathtub, which was made of old yellowed marble, and on the shower curtain, which was a double curtain with a practical plastic inside and an outside of impractical white lacy fabric, and onto the sink and counter, for his flailing about the stricken man had gotten blood everywhere. The woman could not bear leaving the bathroom quite so shocking for a poor chambermaid to clean and swiped at the bloodstains with tissues and toilet paper, while the stricken man continued to peer at himself in the mirror, tried to see the wound at the crown of his head with a kind of pride now and finished brushing his wavy, syrupy white hair that was thin at the crown, was head but thicker elsewhere. He was a sturdy-bodied man of something beyond late middle age, in fact. A former athlete, perhaps, or any rate a man who kept himself fit longer than most out of determination and vanity. The woman found herself admiring the man's body, so much more solid than her own, so much more stolid, that resembled the Greek warrior statues she'd been seeing in the museums. Broad-shouldered men with curly beards, broad chests covered in a sort of pelt, muscular arms and shoulders, legs wrought in the most exquisite antique marble. What gratitude the woman felt, what a flood of relief that the man she discovered in a hotel room had not been seriously hurt, had not been mortally injured. I'll never forget this moment when things might have gone so differently. Feeling better now, decidedly stronger, the man scarcely took note of the woman's mood. Naked and confident, he returned to the bedroom to seek out underwear in a bureau drawer, step into shorts, needing the woman to steady him as he balanced on one leg, navy blue shorts that fitted his drum-like belly almost too tightly. On his torso, a thin, white, much-laundered undershirt through which short, crinkly chest hairs poked like the quills of a small beast. "Will you pick out a shirt for me, dear?" the man asked with a curious sort of submissiveness. "Please." As if, after the debacle of the accident, the man so foolish could not dare to select a shirt for himself. The woman peered into the closet and selected a long-sleeved cotton shirt with a small geometric pattern, dark blue on white, not the sort of shirt an American tourist might wear on a balmy September day in Paris, but a shirt that suggested a measure of dignity and authority, a shirt that might have been worn by a professional man, a Parisian, attorney, physician, professor. The selection of this particular shirt the man appreciated, for the shirt was one of his favorites and fitted his image of himself as essentially dignified and possessing authority, as well as a certain degree of achievement, reputation, and affluence, though, in fact, he was the very man who'd slipped ignominiously on a bathroom floor less than an hour ago, struck his head on the toilet, stunned himself, and might easily have died, in which case he would be dead at this very moment not buttoning up his favorite shirt, an American woman downstairs in the courtyard making annotations in the Paris guidebook would not yet have known what awaited upstairs in room 340 of the Hotel d'Avey. As he dressed and tied his shoelaces, the man could not resist recounting to the woman another time what had happened to him. It was quite a remarkable episode, an accident, a freak accident. Nothing ever happened to him like this before. It would ever happen again. His voice was so expansive, bemused, the woman understood that soon the incident that had occurred in the bathroom would become an anecdote, one of the man's travel anecdotes to impress others, to startle others, to entertain others, to make them feel concerned for the man, even as his affable manner deflected concern, and to make them smile, for there had been no sort of accident involving, there had been no tragedy, no cracked skull, no abrupt and irreparable death, only a comical sort of accident involving a slippery floor, a mere pratfall, the man would call it. So relieved was the woman to see the man in good spirits so relatively quickly after the accident, she came to him to kiss him and to give him a hug, as a mother might give a difficult child a hug, a reassurance, yet chidingly, with a sort of warning and a gesture that the child might or might not acknowledge. And a man thanked her again for saving his life, as he said extravagantly, helping him when he was helpless, banning her breakfast to come to his aid. And he kissed her in return, though distractedly, for there were other things on his mind, and he was very hungry right now, and looking forward to the New York Times downstairs in the courtyard, and the basket of croissants and those jams in miniature jars. By this time, the man was ready to leave the hotel room. The woman had discovered belatedly that she was looking disheveled herself, would have to comb her hair again. To her horror, she saw there were blood smears on both the white linen jacket and the perfectly creased trousers, and so she would have to change her clothes. The man was leafing through the guidebook which the woman had brought to the room, telling her he wanted to see that morning, wasn't the Musée d'Orsay, but the Musée Picasso. He'd never seen the Musée Picasso, he said. Every time he'd come to Paris, he'd wanted to see it, and he never had. The woman objected. She thought they had agreed on the Musée d'Orsay, and the woman said, no, they'd agreed on the Picasso. Looking at the guidebook the previous day, that was what they decided. The woman protested faintly, but it was no use. It was never any use. Even if she were correct, and she could not now absolutely recall if she were correct, as the man adamantly recalled that he was correct, if he were obliged to give in to her, he would be sulky and sullen and not enjoy the museum, despite its great art and its setting. Better if they visited the Picasso Museum, which was much smaller, would not tax the man's strength so much as the Mab d'Orsay. And no doubt the Picasso Museum would be excellent too. The woman would purchase postcards in the gift shop to send back home, and these would be perfectly adequate. It really didn't matter what the postcards pictured, at which the young grandchildren would do no more than glance, and perhaps not even glance. At last, making their way along the dimly lighted corridor to the carpeted steps, the woman slipped her arm through the man's arm, not to steady him or even to guide him, or rather not obviously to perform these functions, but out of great relief, a vast swell of relief, which would be turned to her through the day in waves, long after the man had more or less forgotten what the reason for such relief might have been, in a Hotel d'Abbe on the Rue de Cassay, Paris. The full title of that is The Bloody Head, A Love Story, so you can sort of see about that. Well, I'm happy to try to answer any questions that you might have. We can talk for 15, 20 minutes or so. This is always the best part of the evening for me, instead of a conversation.
Could people please wait for the microphone? I'll bring it around to you. Is there anybody who has a question?
It's really lovely that you're here. You mentioned a couple of times about being surprised at your own stories. Can you talk a little bit more about that?
Well, it's sort of an interesting phenomenon, and many people who are writers or artists, I think, we start off with a very powerful sense, like a dreamlike sense of an emotion or tone, almost like a musical tone, and I need to have my setting. I have a setting, like this hotel room is very real, and the bathroom, I mean, I could just shut my eyes and see it. It's very vivid to me. So, and then you have people who come into this setting, and they seem in some way related to it, and then a story is stimulated by the interrelating of the people. It could be two or three people, actually. And then it sets something in motion, and whenever I start a story, I always know the ending, except I don't always stay with that ending. So I have a destination that could be like over in that corner, but then as I'm moving along, the characters become maybe suddenly a little rebellious, or they have a little impishness or mischief. They don't really want to do that, so it may swerve and go in another direction. And I think that's true of many people who are writers and artists. Some of my students, I'm teaching at UC Berkeley right now, some of my students claim that they don't know where their stories are headed. And that's like, I think like having a dream where you don't really know where the dream will go. But more conscious writing, it's like a dream, but you have a control over it. Are you a writer? Poetry is a little different because it's all about language, and they're not usually characters. There's not usually a plot or narrative in poetry, though there can be, but not usually.
Okay, we have a question over here.
Oh, sorry.
You can go next.
Okay.
I have a craft question about the story, or really two. One is, the first part is, why did you use almost entirely indirect discourse in this story, so that there's virtually no speech? And the second is, fairly near the end of the story, we suddenly shift points of view from the woman to the man, and we're, for a moment, inside his consciousness. And I wondered why you did that.
I'm not sure that we do. I think she's sort of is identifying with him. But I'm not sure that I'm not sure. I wanted to write a story that was about a fantastic possibility. A woman without a name is in Paris, and she's exactly at this at this table in this wonderful hotel courtyard, and she has all this freedom, which Isabel Archer had but threw away, if you remember the Henry James novel. And so she's thinking how she'll go to the Musée d'Orsay and she'll walk along and do all these things. But then there's this person calling to her, and she cannot look away and she can't say no. And the fantasy sort of dissolves, and she's drawn into this world of pain and need and having to help people and having to assume that she does have a role in life, that she's not really that free, but it is a love story, so there's some compensations. But I couldn't make it a first-person narrative because we would know immediately that the two were connected. It has to be something that starts off with a camera back from the person so that we don't know that she's related to that man at all, and it's as if a camera is recording it. But many a woman in the audience, I'm sure, can identify with this woman where somebody needs you and they made a bad mess, and and that's just what you're going to do that evening, or, you know, that day. So some men were nodding too, so it's not just women. Yes? There's a lavender.
Thank you.
Be next.
Sorry. I was wondering how you handle the time frame of the transition from the writing, the focus, and the very quiet, intense creation of the world, and then your very public passion for public, for the swirl of politics and global events, and I know you're very aware of this. So how do you do that transition?
Well, I don't think of the outer world or the political world or the ephemeral world as having quite the gravitas of art or reading. And when I'm teaching, I'm always teaching from an anthology, so I keep in close contact with great writers like Faulkner and Hemingway. And tomorrow I'm teaching Flannery O'Connor and a Eudora Welty story, which I read many, many times, and they go very well together. A Late Encounter with the Enemy by Flannery O'Connor, and then Eudora Welty's wonderful story, Where's the Voice Coming From? So each time I go to those stories, I feel I'm getting back to some basic, it's almost like a spiritual, ontological essence, whereas those of us who've been around a while, we can remember political crises that were very serious and very upsetting. And we're in a crisis now, it seems, but we were also in crisis in the past. And if there's any advantage with being older is that you do remember other very bad things. You remember really, really bad things. I mean, I'm old enough to remember when we had nuclear atomic bomb drills in the school and how scary that was. It must have been scary, but maybe we're too silly and shallow. We're probably just sort of giggling and didn't really know what it was all about. I don't know, if we had to duck and cover and get under our desks, that must have been a terribly fraught time in our history, but we got through that. So, not that I want to sound too optimistic, because that might not that might not be appropriate. But it's, for me, the writing and the books that I read have this inner reality that's much deeper, whereas Twitter or social media are immediately engaging, sort of like images that are flicked on a wall, and they can be very entertaining and stimulating. And I think we should know about that, but it's probably not going to be as permanent as the other.
Yeah, I read a short story of yours a very long time ago, and I wanted to reread it, but I can't find it. It's about small children who gang up on their parents. Do you remember that? And
oh.
It's about they wear sundresses, or the parents do. It's one of the creepiest stories I've ever read.
I'm not sure that I wrote that. That, I don't remember that. Oh. Well, it's maybe it's a little different from what you're saying. It's making me remember anything exactly. I have lots of weird stories. I have a story called Family. I'm not sure if that's it. It's set in kind of in the future. And the father, something bad happens to the father, and something bad happens to the mother. But I don't think they're wearing sundresses. That's your particular touch.
In the Sign of the Beast. In the Sign of the Beast, how'd you do an adolescent male so well?
Do you think that's an adolescent male? That's very believable. I mean, that's
incredible.
You may be admitting more than you would really want.
it was unbelievable.
Well, I often write about adolescent men. I mean, to write about any man, you're sort of writing about adolescent. Sorry, it's a love story. You have to love them. You have to love them because somebody's got to take care of them. No, I feel a real identification with adolescence. I think adolescence is such an exciting time, and often an adolescent, like the teenagers from Parkland High School, those young people are not hypocrites, and they haven't made the compromises with the world that adults have to make in order to keep going. So I just sort of identify with that kind of person. And I also come from that background, that sort of rural, kind of rough rural background. So I knew these people from my childhood.
Question here.
Where are we?
Hi.
Oh, okay.
Your writing is so wonderfully visual, and it seems a lot of that comes from finding just the absolute perfect detail that illustrates that. And I've always wondered whether that's a whole process that you're, you know, coming up with a detail and crossing it out and coming up with another one, or whether it just comes to you.
Well, I have a fairly strong visual sense. And as I said, I have to have the setting, and I like to know what people are wearing. So I described the man's shirt, mm-hmm. and it's very particularly sort of Tattersall shirt, if you know that kind of shirt. And it is all based upon a real kind of a love and fascination with the actual world. It's a difference between Emerson and Thoreau, where Thoreau is really, really involved with the finite world of nature, whereas Emerson, though he talked about nature, was very abstract. And it's almost, when Emerson talks about a flower, it's almost like he never looked at a flower. They're just sort of platonic ideas of flowers. And I wouldn't find that very rewarding. I really have to have a sense of the actual reality. My friend, the late wonderful John Updike, also had a very strong visual sense. So that one of the pleasures of reading John Updike is that you get a painterly view, a sort of impressionistic painterly view of the scene. I feel that John Updike's settings and his descriptions of the world are really poetic. And then his characters come out, often they don't seem on that plane. Like the Rabbit books are beautifully written, but Rabbit Armstrong himself is very vulgar and crude, a little more than maybe he needs to be. But the writing is so beautiful that one could just sort of ignore the actual people. I try to make my characters inhabit the world and to be sensitive. Even the people who are not nice people may have a poetic sensibility. Are there any writers here?
Questions? One back here.
Yes, of course.
This is a question about one of your earlier stories, I believe published in 2006, Landfill.
Oh, Landfill, yes.
And I just reread it today, and it's just this incredibly powerful piece of writing, which I believe you were criticized for using too much of the realistic details in a case
yes.
that happened in New Jersey and your story set in Michigan.
Yes. Landfill, for me, was very exciting as a formalist experiment because a young man, a fraternity, he's pledging a fraternity in Michigan at a large university. He's very drunk and something ghastly happens to him and he sort of winds up in a dumpster and then he winds up taken away in a trash truck, and he winds up in a landfill. And it is actually based on some horrible thing that happened in New Jersey. But I wanted to write a story that would have the sense of us being in the landfill. So it's all one long paragraph. It has no indentations, no paragraphing. It's like the first sentence is supposed to pull you into the landfill, and then you're just sort of stuck in the landfill to the very end with some movement in time, but basically there's a little narrative, and then there's sort of a subtext of a different narrative of the parents and the boy and what actually happens to him. And we find out what happens to him. I think in real life, in New Jersey, I think it was the College of New Jersey, I don't know that they ever really found out how he got in there. But in my story, you find out. Well, some people thought that I shouldn't write about that because it had really happened, or something like that had happened, but it didn't seem like a very, I mean, I didn't have any names, and everything was really relocated. Also, I'd like to write about events and incidents in the world. I don't necessarily write about people. I wrote my short novel based on a Chappaquiddick incident, which is called Black Water, is really about the event. It's not about actual people. And I don't think that I really have that much interest in this sort of historical, gossipy nature. When I wrote about Marilyn Monroe, I wanted to think of Marilyn Monroe as an iconic person, almost like an every woman or an every man, almost like Moby Dick, sort of. Mm-hmm. The idea that she becomes the blonde actress and she plays this role, and then she's trapped in the role and she can't get out of it. So that there's Norma Jean Baker, but gradually the blonde actress overtakes her. So in the beginning of the novel, there's Norma Jean, who's a girl, and then as the novel moves on, the blonde actress sort of takes over her. So at the end, she's lost her soul. So if you were on a professional trajectory like that, and you were going to become extremely famous and iconic, to use this cliche, there's some point at which you find yourself surrounded by people who never knew you when you were your real self. So there's a certain point in the novel when she looks around, she realizes nobody here knows her as Norma Jean. Now they all think of her as Marilyn. And that was kind of like the beginning of the end, losing one's soul.
You may have answered this already, but I'm wondering, have you identified in yourself some quality of your mind that enables you to become, to be the writer that you are, other than that strong visual sense that you mentioned?
I don't really understand the question exactly. I don't really know. Do you want to rephrase it? You're asking how we all become the people we are?
No, I'm asking how you became the writer you are and what special quality of your mind you may have identified that enables you to be the prolific and excellent writer that you are. You mentioned, for example, your strong visual sense and Updike's. Is that a common finding in good writers?
No, I don't think so. I don't see much visual dimension, for instance, in Beckett. Beckett has a very strong sort of musical voice. But I think there are a number of Borges, they tend to be very philosophical and cerebral rather than visual. James Salter has a very strong visual imagination. He's really quite powerful. And Thomas Hardy, he's describing things. Some writers, I think, Dickens. Dickens had a very almost synesthesiac, is that the word? It's like everything everything was buoyant and energetic in Dickens. So that the energy of the writer is communicated to the prose. But I don't know, it's a good question. Some of my students have a natural aptitude for writing somewhat intellectual and analytical concept stories because they may be majoring in science. And others are more like poets or artists. They're not concerned with philosophy or analysis, but just with impressions. I don't know. I tend to be interested in form, and It excited me to write a story that was all one paragraph because it was landfill. But having done that once, I can't do it again. So that's the trouble with being a formalist, because you sort of, you want an exciting form. I felt the form for Black Water was exciting, but I can't do that again. So I look with a kind of nostalgia on the things that I have done once that were challenging and difficult, but I did it, and I can't go back and do it again.
I have a question over here.
Yes.
Hi. So I think someone mentioned earlier about you writing well from a young boy's perspective. And I really think throughout all your work, you've written, you know, from a range of perspectives, and you do them all so well. And so I wonder, you know, when you're creating, you know, something, how you decide what perspective you're going to tell it from, what character. Has it ever happened where you're, you know, writing a story or something, and you decide, I think maybe this is a different character's story, and try it a different way?
Well, in the beginning of any project, like the beginning of a novel, for instance, the first 6 weeks are extremely blundering and frustrating, and you're stumbling and staggering, and you really don't know what's going to happen. So there's that time, maybe semi-consciously, one is trying out different things. You're trying different voices. I do so many pages over and over again at the beginning of a novel. It's ludicrous. I mean, people would laugh in pity and terror if they saw how many times I just type something over, a kind of a talismanic way of typing something. But then as it goes on, and I get to page, you know, 100, I more or less have that rhythm, so I don't have to do quite that much. And that's hard. It's hard to explain why that happens. Now, there are people who work on a novel for 20 years or so, and they have a manuscript that they don't want to admit has gone dead. So they keep working on this, and that it's sort of like trying to reanimate the corpse in Frankenstein or something. You know, like, well, they did give life to Frankenstein, but it was sort of a mistake. But I had one novel called The Accursed that I had put away for a long time. I started writing it in 1984, I think, and was finished a long time ago, and then I took it out about 2010 or 11 and worked on it again. That's most unusual. Often something is so exciting at the time, but then if you don't somehow put it into form, it fades away. It's like meeting somebody with whom you may fall in love or have an intense relationship or friendship at just the right time in your life. But by a couple weeks or months or years missing, that's not going to happen. Who knows why this is? It's sort of like magic.
Question here.
Hello. My question is on creative writing programs. Do you, and I recognize there's many ways to be a writer. Do you think that creative writing programs are more successful than simply writing and submitting your work, or equally successful or less successful? Do you have an opinion about that?
Are they more successful than?
Well, so once upon a time, let's say take Faulkner, for example. He wrote and he submitted his books. He did not go through a creative writing program.
No, he got a D in English.
And so the question I have really is simply, is it better to write and submit your books or submit your writing? Or do the creative writing programs give the student a competitive edge when they submit their work?
Yes, I think the writing programs give the students definitely a competitive edge. I think, now my students are very solicitous of one another and very kind and sympathetic. So they sit around, our 15 students, and they are very tenderly concerned with one another, and so they give one another advice. Sometimes it turns out that a student will turn a story in and nobody even realized what happened. So the student says, oh, you know, like you forgot to put that in, we tell them. And so they learn from that. Whereas if this person were all alone, just writing by himself, he'd send that work out to an editor, it would just be rejected, and he would never know. So the student whose work is being critiqued is supposed to sit quietly and just listen. And so the pretense is that editors are working and thinking and talking about the manuscript, but the writer can listen but isn't supposed to talk. Though sometimes they put their hand up and say, let me explain what I was trying to do. And I have to be very, very considerate, and I explain, it doesn't matter what you were trying to do, because it only matters what we think, what the text shows. Yes, overall, the writers, I've had a number of writers who came from my writing workshops in Princeton, and a lot of them are really, really successful. Mohsen Hamid, he wrote Exit West. He's very, very successful. Suddenly, I looked around, and he would graduated from Princeton. A couple years later, he was like the leading Pakistani writer. I mean, how did that happen? And Jonathan Safran Foer, F-O-E-R, he was my student also. And Jonathan had success at a relatively young age. So there is something to be said just for the community experience of being in a workshop. And some of the writers remain friends with one another through their whole lifetimes, and they send one another their work. It's much less lonely, because writing is a very lonely occupation. So if you have a nice workshop group of people who care about you, that's very helpful.
Question here.
I've read, like many people here, your stories over the years, and I always felt if I wanted to rotate between Poe and I wanted some other take on horror or the gothic, I would read you. And so I thought, you know, often writers and painters come from difficult childhoods and backgrounds, but I've been reading your memoirs of your childhood, and it's astounding how loved you were and how much you loved your parents. And it does,
I was lucky.
You know, there's a disconnect, yes, between, and your memoirs are so lovely. And you went to school in a one-room schoolhouse, and just, they supported you so much. So there's just this disconnect between, wow, where did all that come from? I don't know how you can answer that. But there is the story in your memoirs of your teenage friend, your girlfriend, who you drifted apart when you went away to college, and that reads almost like horror, that final moment and the word you mentioned, Drano, at the end.
Oh, yes, the first person I ever knew about who committed suicide.
Ah, that yeah. was chilling.
Yeah.
It had been going so well. I was reading, oh, she's so happy. What a lovely childhood.
Well, I think that the childhood itself, the family life was really good, and my parents were very loving. But we were really surrounded by what's now called dysfunctional people. I mean, that's just a word, that's a cliche now, but very poor people. And I was just sort of lucky. And one of the things that I was writing about in my memoir, and maybe some of my writing, my fiction, is how strange it was that we had this island of protectiveness and love, but then like just next door, the family next door, because of alcoholism and maybe just plain ignorance, the father was so mean and so vicious. And I always thought, what if I were in that family? And so one of the reasons I think that I'm motivated to write is of telling the stories of these other girls who had these terrible families. I still hear from that girl. We send each other, the girl, she's not a girl any longer, but we send each other letters like once a year, birthday cards, our birthdays are around the same time in June. So she got out of that environment and she endured, you know. But I think if you have a family who loves and supports you and protects you, then you're basically sort of insulated through much in life. Freud said if someone has a mother who loves him, what was that? He will be successful in love and work, some remark like that. But I'm just so sympathetic with people like Norma Jean Baker or Marilyn Monroe, who didn't have a mother who loved her, and she didn't have any father at all. So I felt very sorry and very sympathetic for her.
Yes. There's a question over here.
I read a story that you wrote one time whose name I can't recall, but it was a story of a young teenage man who was murdering people, and I was, or someone.
Zombie?
That was it, yes. And I was drawn into the logic of his mind so that it was almost scary. I could understand why he was doing that. And I wonder if, from an imaginative point of view, you understand these men who are killing, young boys who are killing people everywhere. Do you have any understanding of that?
Well,
that
we don't? I don't know. I feel I could understand virtually anything. I can, if I think and meditate about it, any sort of human activity has its own dark logic. He's the character Quentin in Zombie is what we call a sociopath or a psychopath. And it was interesting to write about that person because he had no feelings for anyone. Some of us are overly emotional. We would be terribly upset if we saw a kitten injured or a squirrel run over in the street. You know, we would be really, really upset. Whereas these people would run over them in the street. You know, they would just sort of drive on and they wouldn't even notice or care about it. So I was writing about somebody also to whom women were somewhat contemptible, of no interest, but if any interest, are contemptible, because he was a homicidal sort of possessive homosexual who had no tenderness or feeling for anyone, but particularly no interest in women. So it was interesting for me to write about the women in his life who imagined that they could charm him or, you know, flirt with him, and how funny that is when it's just not working and they don't understand. And so that was an interesting exercise for me as a writer to see that kind of disconnect.
So yes. You've written so much. What do you see as the biggest risk that you can take next as a writer?
Well, I'd like to write another long novel. I just need to have a subject. I do have a long novel coming out in a couple of years, but my novel Blonde, though it was very taxing and frustrating, and I was really quite exhausting. Russell Banks and I, my dear friend, Russell Banks and I both teaching at Princeton, he wrote his great novel, Cloud Splitter, which is about John Brown, John Brown's son. And Russell's novel's about this big, and my novel's about this big. And Russell and I both said, we commiserated, we would never, ever write another long novel. But I think Russell's gone on to write another fairly long novel, and I have also. And so it's like that feeling people have where they're enlisting again for another tour of hell. Got back from hell. Well, after a while, you get sort of restless. You but well, things are just so easy and pleasant. I think I'll go back to hell. Because when I was working on a novel, I was always sort of excited, and it was like my heart was going a little faster. So I would like to maybe think about that. I've had projects that come in and out of my head, but I haven't. You know if it's not going to have traction. Well, that novel was 1,400 pages of manuscript.
Wow.
Yeah, it got cut down, and then when it's printed, it's less. But a certain kind of madness overcomes you, like a red mist, when you go from three digits, 999, to four digits, 1,000. Very few people have that experience, and no poets. No poets ever have. Like you're at 999, and then the next page is 1,000. That is so horrific. So that's only happened once. Maybe it would never happen again. I once thought I wanted to write a novel about Joe Louis, and it was going to be a very, very deep immersion in that world. And I got very excited about it, but somehow I never, maybe the time went by, and I never really quite did that. But that story is so fraught with irony and poignancy. I'm drawn to these tragic Americans who embody so much more than their own lives, but it's like they're almost charismatic figures, and they almost suffer for other people. Joe Louis, he came to a kind of sad end. At one time, he was almost like a savior figure in America.
Question right here, last question.
Also very, very good. I think you gave me my cue when you said no poets, because I wanted to raise the topic of your poetry, your very good poetry. I think the first poem I read of yours, and this is not a quiz, but was called Night Thoughts.
Oh,
Night Thoughts was published by California Quarterly out of UC Davis.
A long time ago.
And there's certain things I do see in your poem. There'll be moments where you just collar the reader and say, aren't you convinced that? And then you'll say something sharp and smart. And the question would be, Night Thoughts also, like your story today, deals with the morning. The last ending of it is a dark interpretation of the morning. Today we heard somebody who initially clings to her precious morning. So I'm asking two questions, how you regard your poetry, and why this consistent theme of the morning.
Well, the poetry that I write, it tends to be a poetry of voice, someone's voice. Sometimes it's a monologue. A lot of my poetry tends to be the human voice. So it could be a monologue, and it's like a little story, a narration. I have a long poem, like about 5 or 6 pages long, to Marlon Brando in Hell. And that goes through Marlon Brando's life to some extent, not every part of it, but hitting upon the major parts of his life. And it's told in a certain voice, like a pleading voice, a person who's actually obviously in love with Marlon Brando, but is very angry at what he did to himself. And so it's not my voice, but it's a voice of some character, like a fictitious character. Emily Dickinson spoke of the voice of the I narrator in her poetry is not herself. It could be a boy.
Get your cash box.
It could be an older person. Sometimes it seems like Emily Dickinson, but basically it's a fictitious person. And then Morning. I have a story called Morning. That's one of my favorite stories, but I don't think I'm particularly drawn to writing about morning. Probably nighttime is more evocative. So are you a poet?
No.
Oh, okay. Thank you so much.